Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Pivot of the Universe, Nasiruddin Shah and the Iranian Monarchy, 1831 to 1896, by Abbas Amanat. Narrated by Derek Perkins. Preface. This book is about the institution of monarchy in modern Iran. It focuses on the life and times of Nasiruddin Shah Qajar, 1831 to 1896, during the first phase of his reign between 1848 and 1871. In this study, I have tried to answer a fundamental question. How did monarchy, the centerpiece of an ancient political order, withstand and adjust to the challenges of modern times, both international and domestic? Nasiruddin Shah's life and career, his upbringing and personality, and his political conduct provide remarkable materials for such a study. His life reflects dilemmas and vulnerabilities shared by most rulers of the Islamic world in the 19th century, though few shared his resilience in facing the hazards and upheavals that characterized the early part of his long reign. By examining how he was transformed from an insecure crown prince and later an erratic boy king in the 1840s and 1850s, into a ruler with substantial control over his government and foreign policy in the 1860s and beyond, this study attempts to explore a pattern in the consolidation of traditional monarchies that often perpetuated, rather than being hampered by, the forces of modernity. European impact during the reign of Nasiruddin Shah was not only limited to military expansion and diplomatic competition between Iran's two powerful neighbors, Russia and Britain. Europe also offered an alternative model to the traditional concept and practice of government to which rulers such as Nasiruddin Shah were accustomed. Preserving the balance between tradition and modernity, resisting the West, yet conforming to it, thus became a vital concern for Nasiruddin Shah, adding a new dimension to his task of maintaining the delicate socio-political equilibrium. Increasing popular dissent, ministerial autonomy under Amir Kabir and Mirza Aga Khan Nuri, the endemic factionalism of the Qajar polity, and the Shah's personal vulnerabilities were other strains upon the fragile cycle of equity, the upkeep of which was the Shah's ancient duty. Yet against these odds, Nasiruddin Shah survived on his throne for nearly 50 years, 1848 to 1896. Indeed, it is possible to suggest that Nasiruddin's reign was the beginning of monarchical absolutism in a modern sense. The Shah combined shrewd diplomacy, often playing off rival European powers against each other, with selective reforms and equally shrewd weakening of traditional checks and balances to increase his own political power at the expense of ministerial autonomy. With the exception of some important lapses during the constitutional revolution, the same process continued to hamper state modernization into the late 20th century. The fall of the premier Mossadegh in 1953, almost 100 years after the fall of Amir Kabir and the subsequent consolidation of Mohammad Reza Shah Pahlavi, was yet another episode in the struggle between the monarch and minister for the control of the government. More than a decade after the dramatic collapse of the Pahlavi dynasty, and beyond the political setting in which ancient monarchy was glorified and the Qajar period despised, we can put into historical perspective an institution that, for more than 25 centuries, constituted the most fundamental component of Persian political identity. It is sanguine to believe that the demise of monarchy entailed the immediate loss of its most pervasive elements from Iran's political culture, even though it was removed by an anti-monarchical revolution. That the Persian monarchy was one of the oldest and most influential in history only sanctions the endurance of this legacy, which is evident even in the way power is perceived and practiced in the post-monarchical period. Ingrained deeply into Persian historical consciousness, the mythological dimensions of kingship also have received a new lease on life. Shahnameh, one of the greatest epics of all times, is, after all, the Book of the Kings. Even on a personal level, the reign of Nasiruddin Shah still has tangible effects. When I was a young boy growing up in Tehran, I once asked my grandfather about his age. With a familiar pose that must have given him time to return to old memories, he could only give his approximate age. I was a boy of 6 or 7 playing ball in my hometown, Kashan, when the news of Nasir al-Din Shah's assassination arrived. Even at that young age, I found it fascinating that the death of a ruler should serve as the starting point in my grandfather's personal history. Some 4 decades later, I can see why that was a turning point for the people of his generation. The break with the ancient past of which Nasir al-Din was a symbol was as swift as the bullet fired from his assassin's pistol. My grandfather was a living link between me and that moment, only a lifespan away from the reign of Iran's last traditional monarch. In these post-monarchical days, after a century of change and the tumult of 2 revolutions, that age seems to us even more remote. But remoteness has diminished neither its relevance nor its fascination for all those who seek answers to Iran's, and in a broader sense the Middle East's, transition to modernity in the crucial decades of the latter half of the past century. Recognizing the position of monarchy in Perso-Islamic political experience is not to abide by the essentially misconceived notion of Persian despotism. From Herodotus and Aristotle to Montesquieu and Hegel, the stereotype of an omnipotent Oriental despot with the powers of life and death over his prostrating subjects captured Western imaginations for reasons having more to do with philosophical and political ideals in the West than with historical realities in the East. As early as the Greco-Persian Wars of the 5th century BC, the West looked upon Persian monarchy as its political other, contrived in order to augment its own political consciousness. Even up to the present time, the complexity of the Persian kingship model and the functional position of the ruler is often overlooked in the works of non-specialists in favor of the more fascinating but less historically applicable notion of divine kingship and the position of the Shah or Sultan as the shadow of God on earth. Throughout the course of Islamic history, this functional model of kingship served almost unanimously to reconcile the temporal power with the premises of Islam. The fact that the Qajar state was one of the last, if not the last, to be faithful to this model of government makes it all the more interesting. In contrast to renowned rulers of ancient and Islamic eras who presented the archetypes of traditional monarchy in largely self-contained settings, Nasir al-Din Shah and his counterparts in the Ottoman Empire, Egypt, and elsewhere were facing essentially different circumstances. Nasir al-Din lived in the age of Europe's imperial advances, its growing technological edge, and its penetrating profusion of new ideas and institutions. He ruled over a society weakened by economic stagnation and civil strife, discontented with political and clerical repression, but still profoundly bound by patriarchal norms and values. Nasir al-Din's views and conduct thus exemplified the dilemma of rulers with the unenviable task of implementing change from above. Nasir al-Din's long reign in the age of high imperialism and internal instability raises another question. Why was he not overthrown by more potent pretenders to the Qajar throne or by potentially powerful movements of popular dissent? Why was his throne not overrun by the advancing armies of his northern neighbor, nor annexed by his neighbor in the south? Except for the almost inevitable peripheral losses in Herat and Marv, why did the frontiers of the guarded domains of Iran remain intact? Given the government's overall inefficiency and obvious symptoms of misgovernment, the answers to such questions are even more intriguing. Was it merely, as has often been argued, the balance of power between the competing imperial neighbors and their shared desire to preserve a buffer state that prolonged the life of another sick man, this one on the threshold of India? Or did Nasir al-Din's domestic and foreign policies effectively arrest European advances? Selective reforms and a weakening of the old checks and balances allowed the Shah to put a distinctive personal mark on the socio-political system. Nasir al-Din's royal touch was more profound than that which meets the eye at first glance. During his reign, the monarch's symbolic centrality to his own world, as reflected in the royal epithet, the pivot of the universe, Gebleya Olam, took on an even more assertive character. His fears and suspicions, which were rooted in his troubled upbringing, were sharpened by the political insecurities of his reign. His emotional losses were compensated for by vengeful rejection of his fatherly ministers. Such motives had an irreversible impact on his reign and the decades that followed. The execution of his first premier, Mirza Taqi Khan Amir Kabir, serves as only one example. His narcissistic dispositions and profligacy as motives for military ventures or granting economic concessions were further examples. On the positive side, the same personal characteristics, when grafted onto his originally nomadic survival talents, led him to resist foreign advances. This nascent patriotism helped preserve his kingdom's territorial integrity. His cultural and artistic interests and religious leanings also helped sustain a cultural heritage still agile and confident of its own norms and worldview. Amplified in the historical space far beyond his human stature, Nasir ad-Din was still the center of his own universe. 100 years after his death, the image of Nasir ad-Din Shah still lingers, not only in popular history books and other literature of decline, but also in oral anecdotes and comical stories. The air of fantasy and farce that surrounds his image is a curious switch from the image of the tyrant nurtured by his contemporary sources. It is equally distant from the martyr king, Shah-e-Shahid, persona created in the decades following his assassination. Thanks to what may be called a moralistic historiography, aspects of gullibility and greed were attached to his battered image beyond all realistic proportions. The sympathetic Shah Baba, literally Papa King, rendered in Sadegh Hidayat's masterpiece Tuper Morvari, by contrast, betrays a nostalgia for patrimonial kingship. Yet Hidayat's portrayal of Nasir ad-Din Shah, when set against the parody of the modernity of the Pahlavi era, religious obscurantism and colonial legacy, more accurately highlights the plights and pleasures of that age. The current revival of interest in the Qajar era, and particularly the enthusiasm for Nasir ad-Din Shah beyond sheer entertainment value, reflects Hidayat's preoccupation with the dilemma of modernity. In this study, I try to depict that past in a light of objectivity often missing from accounts of the Nasiri era and after. Demonstrating the interaction between the political and the personal in the career of Nasir ad-Din Shah, and making sense of it as a case study of monarchy in transition, thus poses a challenge far more taxing than writing a conventional political biography or an intimate account of his life. For a comprehensive study of Nasir ad-Din Shah, the vast amount of primary material on the political history of his reign is as relevant as the most intimate memoirs, diaries, and travelogues. Direct involvement in the government made the Shah's personal touch detectable in the most essential issues, as well as in the most mundane. The peculiar fashion by which the official and unofficial dimensions of his rule intermingled poses an additional challenge to the historian, not only in terms of coverage and organization, but also in trying to chart the boundaries of the Shah's authority and intervention. This ground, in spite of its richness, has remained largely unexplored. Studies of diplomacy, reform, bureaucracy, religion, and economy in the Nasir ad-Din period, carried out by Lambton, Kazemzadeh, Kedi, Bahash, Algar, and others, in spite of their significance by virtue of their very focus, were only marginally interested in the ruler's function and the interaction between its formal and private aspects. By relying on primary sources, most of them unknown or scarcely utilized, and taking a fresh look at better-known primary accounts, I hope to contribute to the biographical studies in the Middle East, as well as to modern Iranian historiography. To this author, the charm of history lies in its totality, in its multifaceted intricacy, and in the mysterious reality that emerges only when seemingly innocuous facts are brought together. Thus, at times I found it necessary to cross the divisional barriers that often place a work of history in one or another category, in order to demonstrate the complexity of Nasir ad-Din Shah's character and his age. Preface to the paperback edition. The story of this book The Life and Times of Nasir ad-Din Shah Qajar, above all, is the story of power and its elusive nature, how it is gained, how it is held in the face of many odds, and how it is lost to inertia and popular discontent. Nasir ad-Din Shah is perhaps a ruler remembered most by posterity, often too harshly, as the embodiment of lost opportunities. His portrayal is often contrasted in the Iranian grand narrative with that of his first premier, Amir Kabir, perhaps the most iconic figure of Persian modern history, whose rise and tragic downfall is depicted. This book is also about other men and women who loyally served the Shah, abided by his whims and wishes, threatened and manipulated him, and fell victim to his fears and suspicions. A decade after the first publication of Pivot of the Universe, I am pleased to note that the specialists and the general public read it not only for an alternative look at the Qajar political landscape, but for its relevance to the nature of power, even in our time. Here we read about the upbringing, family and dynastic ties, and political career of a 19th century ruler who was largely bound by the norms and practices of the ancient institution of Persian kingship, and yet at the same time faced numerous modern challenges at home from his own subjects and from European imperial powers. The old dilemma of preserving a domestic balance of power loomed larger for him than his ancestors in the face of court intrigues, vagaries of governance, dire finances, and fundamental obstacles to change. Without subscribing to an essentialist view of history, and without assuming that the same political pattern unchangeably persisted over centuries, the parallels with the later rulers of Iran are instructive and at times striking. Economy aside, challenges to Nasir ad-Din Shah may resemble similar ones in the 20th century posed to the Pahlavi ruler Mohammad Reza Shah, as depicted, for instance, in the recently published secret diaries of Asadullah Alam, the influential court's minister, or even the conduct of today's actors in Iran's Islamic Republic. Drawing such a parallel is revealing because of Iran's geopolitically pivotal location, then and now. Today's Iran, more than a century after the death of Nasir ad-Din Shah, still struggles to hold its ground in a highly volatile regional surrounding, which in the 20th century is somewhat inadequately defined as the Middle East. Iran still has to maintain a complex power balance between its northern and southern frontiers, while remaining wary of the perils that linger to its east and to its west. The frontiers of Russian Empire, true, have now nearly shrunken to its pre-imperial age. After nearly 300 years, Iran no longer shares common borders with its powerful and often intrusive neighbor to the north. Yet Russia certainly remains an important counterforce to Western powers then and now. One of the redeeming qualities of Nasir ad-Din Shah was to master the art of counterbalancing rival superpowers of his time and maintain his own margin of survival in the hostile world of high imperialism. His nearly half century of rule was a quest to learn this hard-to-perfect art of preserving the equilibrium. The Imperial Britain of Nasir ad-Din Shah's time, with all its meddling in Iran's domestic affairs and its condescending attitude to the Persian state, too, has long disappeared, except for a brief misadventure during the recent invasion of Iraq, though it left behind in West Asia, South Asia, and the Persian Gulf lasting legacies of conflict and contention. The Ottoman Empire, too, another source of anxiety to the Qajar state, has long disappeared and been replaced with several nation-states that still carry the troubling burden of that imperial demise. Iraq is one such example. Nasir ad-Din Shah, who liked to call himself the King of the Shiites, realized how the destiny of Iraq and its Shiite and Kurdish populations were crucial to the stability of Iran's western frontiers, a fact that badly eludes the American administration today. For nearly two millennia, perhaps as early as the Roman-Parthian Wars of the first century, rulers of the Iranian world resisted and often contested threats coming from the Mesopotamian lowlands. The peace treaties of Amasya in 1555, Zobah in 1639, and Erzurum in 1847, as well as the Algerian Declaration of 1977 between Mohammad Reza Shah Pahlavi and Saddam Hussein, and the ceasefire agreement of 1988 that ended the horrendous Iraq-Iran war, were but a few signposts in this troubled history. Equally important and misunderstood in the West, and by the current US administration in particular, is how the Iranian state historically was vulnerable to dangers in its eastern and northeastern borders, and especially the Afghan frontier. This was demonstrated by the Ghalzai-Afghan invasion of 1722 that destroyed the Safavid state and plunged Iran into many decades of turmoil and civil war. Subsequently, the same threat led to harsh measures by Nadir Shah Afshar to pacify the Kandahar province and beyond. In the 19th century, the permanent loss to Iran of its historic Herat province was followed by the emergence of a united Afghanistan. The former was one of the bleakest moments in Nasir ad-Din Shah's reign, while the latter proved to be a source of relief for the security of eastern Iran. More than a century later, a series of events triggered by the 1980 Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, and subsequently the resistance movement against Soviet occupation, rekindled Iran's old anxieties about its eastern neighbor. The Afghan refugee crisis that obligated Iran to admit more than 1.5 million refugees, and finally the ominous rise of Saudi-backed Taliban with expressed hostility to the Shiites and the Iranians, were the later ominous developments. Nasir ad-Din Shah, of course, is not remembered, somewhat unfairly, for his diplomatic skills. His reign is often labelled as an era of submissiveness toward foreign powers, in the same way that his domestic policies are identified with stagnation and decadence. The hostile treatment in the historiography of the Pahlavi era, inspired by the Western positivist narrative, have had a fair share in such portrayal. And no doubt the obvious shortcomings and blind spots of Nasir ad-Din's rule were too many to be denied or ignored. The murder of his first premier, Mirza Taqi Khan Amir Kabir, has gained a mythical dimension overshadowing almost all other aspects of Nasir ad-Din's reign. This display of hero-worshipping, embellished by the nationalist narrative of earlier decades, came at the expense of any balanced assessment of Nasir ad-Din's long rule, or a realistic view of Amir Kabir's success and failures. The reader of Pivot of the Universe in its Persian translation, it first appeared in Tehran in 2004 as Gebleya Olam, was offered an alternative interpretation to this excessive glorification. This translation generated a fair amount of interest among the book-reading public, to the extent that it was ranked by the Iranian press as one of the most widely debated books of 2005. Even though some Iranian conspiracy theorists diagnosed a plot to blemish the image of an Iranian national icon, the urge for a more realistic reading of the past seems to have prevailed. Evidence of some healthy intellectual vibrancy among the Iranian readership who have bought 3 editions of this book in 2 years. Oddly enough, the customary negative portrayal of Nasir ad-Din Shah goes hand in hand with some curious commemoration of his popular image. At a time when the Islamic Republic tries hard to obliterate images of the Iranian monarchy, but apparently not hard enough, the poorly manufactured iconic images of Nasir ad-Din Shah abound on fake Qajaresque porcelain and china tea sets, teapots, water pipes, decorative plates, vases, and trays. A far cry from the old Gardner china label manufactured in Russia in the 19th century, and the Bohemian glass popularized after Nasir ad-Din Shah's first trip to Europe in 1873. He should at least be congratulated for imprinting himself indelibly on the Iranian popular memory, more successfully perhaps than any other historical or even mythical figure. That there is a kind of mindless quality to these faddish reproductions may tell us something about a collective desire, almost subliminal, to celebrate a bygone epoch, of which now only a shadowy mystique lingers. Not to bolster such generic images in textbooks or on teacups, this book aims toward a more accurate and dispassionate depiction of that epoch without, I hope, removing its story-like luster. As is the case with any serious biography, and there are not too many of them about personalities in the Persianate world, this book is meant to be critical without being overburdened with analysis. As the reader will see, it does not include preamble with the recantation of a fashionable theory, and it does not dutifully invoke big names. For those who are interested in historiographical themes, however, there is an ample amount underneath the narrative, for instance, in the blend of political with personal histories, a deliberate attempt to break down the formalistic divide in biographical narratives. To this end, there is a new approach toward understanding of the man and his time, and, of course, the political institutions and the society that shaped him, and in turn he helped to shape for the posterity. A.A. North Haven, Connecticut. Note on transliteration and style. The transliteration system adopted for Persian and Arabic is that of the International Journal of Middle East Studies, but without diacritical marks. The silent H in Persian and Arabic is represented by A, and the silent Vav in Persian with W. The letter Ain is represented by an inverted comma, and Hamza, regardless of its bearer, by an inverted comma. The Persian Ezafa in proper names and titles is not represented except when necessary. With few exceptions, the Arabic definite article Al is not assimilated to the noun. Persian works with Arabic titles are transliterated in Arabic. Whenever possible, Russian proper names were used in their anglicized form. Well-known place names are written in their common form, as in the Oxford Atlas, and less familiar place names are transliterated. Iran, instead of Persia, is used throughout, but Persian is preferred over Iranian for individuals, regardless of their ethnic origins, as well as for culture, society, and government. All Persian and European civil and military titles are omitted except where necessary. Following the usage of the time, both autograph and autographed note are used for royal decrees, letters, and other documents signed by the Shah, Dast Khat. Prime Minister and Premier are preferred to Grand Vizier as translations for Sadr-e Azam. Dates in Islamic lunar calendar indicated with Q for Qamari. Dates with no lunar signifier are in the Persian solar calendar. In all instances, equivalents were given in Christian Gregorian calendar. Introduction. The Royal Domain. The long reign of Nasiruddin Shah, 1848 to 1896, the fourth monarch of the Qajar dynasty, 1785 to 1925, in many respects epitomized the transitional nature of Qajar rule. The world that emerged under the Qajars bridged the Safavid, 1501 to 1722, and post-Safavid periods with the Iran of the 20th century. During the early Qajar era, Iran, Persia as it was then known to the West, emerged from the political turmoil and economic decline of the late 18th century, with a relatively stable central government, increased social homogeneity, an expanding economy, and gleams of cultural and religious revival. From the first quarter of the 19th century, Iran also experienced diverse challenges from outside its borders. Russia and Britain came into extensive contact with Iran in its northern and southern frontiers, not only through war, diplomacy, and trade, but later by introducing new social and political ideas and institutions. Unlike India to its southeast and the Caucasus and Central Asia to its north, Iran was never conquered or colonized by its European neighbors, but, like the Ottoman Empire to its west, it never remained immune from the European powers' all-embracing and often intrusive presence. It did not abandon its own political system, culture, and way of life. Yet it did not shun altogether Europe's material and later cultural dominance. Gradual awareness of, yet ambivalence toward, the West's pervasive ways was at the heart of the Qajar experience. It is not by mere coincidence that Europe's long century, as the period between the 1789 French Revolution and the 1914 outbreak of World War I is known, finds a certain resonance in the Qajar period. The Persian long century began in earnest in 1785, with the accession to the throne of Aghor Muhammad Khan, 1785 to 1797, the founder of the Qajar dynasty, and came to an effective end with the Constitutional Revolution, 1906 to 1911. The establishment of the Qajar dynasty under Aghor Muhammad Khan unified the country and created an enduring equilibrium after nearly half a century of chronic upheaval. The Constitutional Revolution, by contrast, was an attempt to develop democratic institutions based on the rule of law, conscious nationalism, and secular reforms. The period in between witnessed a long, often painful process of transformation and adjustment to the internal and external realities that defined modern Iran as a state and a nation. During the first 6 decades of Qajar rule, 3 overlapping themes shaped the Persian state and society. In rough chronological order, the first of these was the loosening of tribal loyalties and their gradual replacement with traditional patterns of monarchy and bureaucracy. The second was the encounter with European powers and subsequent adjustment to their strategic and economic contingencies. And the third was the state's interaction with indigenous social and religious forces that sometimes challenged its legitimacy. None of these themes proved detrimental to the survival of the Qajar state, but they combined to produce a serious crisis in the decade leading up to Nasir ad-Din's accession. From the Tent to the Throne. In the 126 years between the fall of the Safavid state in 1722 and the accession of Nasir ad-Din Shah, the Qajars evolved from a shepherd-warrior tribe with strongholds in northern Iran into a Persian dynasty with all the trappings of a Perso-Islamic monarchy. Before Aghor Muhammad Khan could place the Qayanid crown on his head in 1785, 3 generations of the Qajars had lost their lives in the struggle for the throne. As a prominent contingent within the Gizilbash Confederacy, the military elite of the Safavid era, the Qajar chiefs considered themselves legitimate candidates for royal power. During the 3 interregnums in the 18th century, they fought bloody contests with other claimants to the Persian crown, first with Nadir Shah, 1736-1747, and his Afsharid successors, and then with Karim Khan Zand, 1750-1779, and his successors. It was not just out of flattery that court chroniclers of later decades reconstructed the early history of the Qajar dynasty. By elevating 3 generations of Qajar chiefs to the rank of full-fledged kings, they tried to depict the Qajars as legitimate successors to the Safavids, whose right to the throne was usurped by rival dynasties. Aghor Muhammad Khan, who was castrated in his youth by an Afsharid pretender to the throne, a common practice for disqualifying accession, spent years in the Zand court in Shiraz as a hostage for his clan's shaky loyalty. But immediately after Karim Khan's death in 1779, Aghor Muhammad took refuge with his tribe in Nastarabad and began a resurgence that eventually made him the master of Iran. In a series of campaigns that took nearly 2 decades of his life and continued up to the time of his own assassination in 1797, he managed first to subdue the north, and then to supplant Zand rule in the south, and overcome all but the most persistent of his domestic rivals. When, in 1786, he chose Tehran as his capital, he had unified under his rule nearly all of the interior of Iran, though most of the peripheral regions of Azerbaijan and the Caucasus, Khorasan and the Persian Gulf littoral remained outside his reach. Aghor Muhammad Khan's long and sometimes destructive campaigns were in part motivated by desire for conquest and booty and a sense of vengeance against his rivals. Yet he was also an empire builder with a consistent and clear vision. Notwithstanding his infamous greed and cruelty, which brought about the destruction of many of his enemies and some of his supporters, he should be credited for ultimately bringing back security and peace to a country much abused by civil war, famine, and depopulation. The Qajar bid for power was the 3rd successive attempt to create a political order in place of, and on the model of, the Safavid Empire. Being the last in a struggle for domination that, since the 2nd decade of the 18th century, had exhausted the Afghans, Afshars, Zands, and numerous other tribal forces on the Iranian periphery, no doubt was an advantage to the Qajars. Aghor Muhammad Khan won the last phase of the contest because he had been able to build up a potent war machine at the back of his own quarrelling Qajar tribal forces and their allies. There were other reasons, too. The Qajar's rapid adoption of a versatile model of government helped them achieve a state-tribe optimum that had been inconceivable even under a peaceful ruler such as Karim Khan Zand. Moreover, with the emergence of the two European powers on the Iranian horizon at the outset of Qajar rule, the regional climate favoured greater stability. Aghor Muhammad Khan learned from the failures of his predecessors some important lessons in government. He appreciated the collective nature of a tribal enterprise that allowed him to pave the long and bloody way between the Qajar tent camp in Nasirabad and Golestan Palace in Tehran. Yet in his own lifetime he had witnessed the internecine feuding that destroyed previous ruling houses. He thus tried his best to eliminate within and without the Qajar house all actual and potential threats to his designated successor. His nephew and heir apparent, Baba Khan, later known as Fatali Shah, 1797-1834, was the prime beneficiary of Aghor Muhammad Khan's actions. It took another half century before the Qajars could fully eradicate all rivalries within their own house, but the seed of royal supremacy was already sown. The reign of Fatali Shah marked a clear shift from the tribal warring tradition to a model of kingship. Under his rule, the Qajar state was able to expand its control to the peripheries of Azerbaijan, Khorasan, and southern Fars. It also managed to establish an extensive court and administration with all the trappings of a Persian royal system. Fatali Shah's personality and his taste for luxury and royal extravagance, in contrast to the warlike austerity of his uncle, proved remarkably suitable for reconstruction of such a royal system. The early Qajars viewed the men of the sword as prime tools of their domination over the land they conquered. The army created by Aghor Muhammad Khan from a conglomerate of northern tribal forces and maintained by Fatali Shah proved a resilient instrument in the face of early internal dissension and external challenges. Aghor Muhammad Khan's ambition was to restore the old boundaries of the Safavid Empire in the Iranian periphery, to include principalities of Afghanistan and Central Asia, the Ottoman Iraq, all of the Kurdish region and frontiers of Anatolia, the Caucasian provinces, and the Iranian coasts and islands of the Persian Gulf. This plan was only partially modified under Fatali Shah. The same spirit of warfare as the basis of imperial domination remained a part of the Qajar ethos under Muhammad Shah, 1834-1848, and during Nasir ad-Din's early reign. The early Qajars were also keenly aware of the value of the men of the pen, who were responsible for the government administration, Divan. Aghor Muhammad Khan's callous treatment of many real and potential rivals seldom was aimed at state officials. He soon began to appreciate the role of officialdom in creating the state apparatus and overseeing its fiscal and military functions. Fatali Shah was even more consistent in recruiting into his administration secretaries and city officials from Mozandaran and Iraq Ajam, and from remnants of the Zand bureaucratic families of Fars. These officials often held strong bonds with the ulama, the merchants of the bazaar, and with other notables, and served as channels of communication with these groups. In Fatali Shah's service there was also a contingent of Georgians and other Caucasians of slave origin, as well as those who had immigrated from the Caucasus to Azerbaijan after the Persian defeat in war with Russia. Some served as eunuchs and servants of the inner court, and others were in the army. Under Muhammad Shah, a number of these Georgians, along with Kurdish and other peripheral elements, were recruited into important government posts. By the middle of the 19th century, there was an entrenched class of officials acutely aware of its own interests and privileges. Based largely on regional and clan allegiances, they were divided into four informal factions. With a few exceptions, most members of this class were conservative in their worldview and jealously preserved the secrets of their specialized skills. In spite of the enormous power ministers and state accountants wielded throughout the Qajar era, these factions never fully integrated into a unified administrative entity distinct from the court. Their power remained, both in theory and in practice, momentary and contingent on the Shah's arbitrary wishes and thus vulnerable to the machinations of the court and the nobility. They were, as they often wished to assert, a class of servants, tabagaye no kar, in the Shah's retinue. From Nadir's mistakes, the early Qajars also learned the need to court the increasingly influential Shiite establishment, the ulama, the men of religious learning. Even more than Aghor Muhammad Khan, his successor, Fath Ali Shah, ensured their loyalty through patronage, by dispensing gifts and land tenures, and sanctioning their judicial authority. As has often been noted, the Qajars clearly felt they needed the ulama's consent and cooperation in order to buttress their own precarious legitimacy as successors to the Safavids. Whatever the drawbacks of complying with the ulama's wishes, and whatever the ulama's ambivalence in collaborating with the Qajar Shahs, both sides benefited from this symbiosis. The Shahs successfully presented themselves as patrons of the faith and defenders of the Shiite kingdom, whereas the ulama consolidated their social base under the aegis of the state. Greater integration of Shiism in the Qajar era as the religion of the state, and of a vast majority of people, reinforced the state-ulama bonds. The Shah and his court, the princes and the nobility, the army chiefs and the officials, and to an extent the ulama, constituted the ruling elite of the Qajar state. Yet in practice, the effectiveness of the government was hampered by inherent limitations. Throughout the Qajar period, the state suffered from inefficiencies and malfunctions caused by financial restraints, factionalism, organizational confusion, and intrinsic corruption. The state's financial weakness was essentially caused by Iran's stagnant agrarian economy and obstacles to the growth of trade and industrialization, which in turn handicapped the government's ability to raise taxes and improve its archaic methods of expenditure. Moreover, the court and the nobility treated state revenues from the land and other sources as legitimate spoils of the conquest that primarily were to be spent for their upkeep. Little revenue, therefore, was allocated toward meaningful expansion of the state. The officials shared these spoils with the royalty and the Qajar nobility to maintain their economic privileges and ensure monopoly over the bureaucratic machinery. Impediments to strong government were deepened by obstacles at the provincial level. Local power bases, whether chiefs of tribal confederacies or prince governors of the Qajar house, reserved a certain degree of autonomy in the provinces. The Shah maintained a fragile control over these domains, though it is wrong to believe that such control was merely nominal. Depending on the strength of the ruler and his administration, he could maneuver, negotiate, or coerce whichever was expedient, thus holding indirect sway over the provinces. Yet they could not, and indeed did not wish to, reverse the delicate balance between the centre and the periphery. Such devolution of power was seen as cost-efficient and pragmatic. Through practices such as assigning provincial governments to the highest bidder, allotting land and hereditary pensions to the nobility, army officers and court and government officials, and awarding gifts to the ulama, the Shah exercised his royal power in preserving this precarious balance. Punitive measures, such as the dismissal, banishment and execution of guilty officials and chiefs, or whoever posed or was presumed to pose a threat to the royal hegemony, were among other royal options. So was the increasingly abused practice of bestowing grandiose titles to the nobility and to all servants of the state. In exchange, the Qajar elite and the officialdom demonstrated devotion to the Shah, not only through military and civil service, but by paying symbolic and material homage. Such displays of loyalty ranged from substantial gifts, pishkish, presented to the Shah on special occasions to perpetual assurances of humility, devotion, and flattery. That such a system of reciprocal favoritism was prone to serious abuses was acknowledged even by its practitioners. The Shah and his ministers resigned themselves to the fact that no reform measure could remedy the defects of this time-honored system. Increasingly from the second quarter of the 19th century, and more so after the breakdown of the princely system of Fath Ali Shah's time, governorships of provinces were auctioned off to the highest bidders, among princes of the blood, Qajar chiefs, and bureaucrats. From a purely utilitarian standpoint, the Qajar Shahs viewed this annual farming out of provincial offices as an efficient way to raise revenue without directly involving the central government in the costly and laborious practice of collecting taxes. Revolving governorships had, for the Shah, the additional advantage of weakening the semi-autonomous power bases of princes and members of the nobility. Yet this system routinely exposed the public, particularly the villagers, to the indiscretion and avarice of provincial and district governors and their tax collectors. Governors tended to look upon their posts as transitory means of generating income, not only to recoup the initial sums they pledged to the central government, but also to amass a surplus income, madohel, for themselves and their agents. In such a hierarchy of oppression, there was little incentive for fairness and compassion. As the central government's ability to raise income dwindled, officials' incentive to maximize their surplus earnings swelled, thus turning the madohel into an institutionalized form of corruption at every level of government. The Shah and his subjects. Even as late as the Qajar period, the monarchy was profoundly influenced by the ancient tradition of Persian kingship. Yet it is unrealistic to assume that the Qajar monarchy remained unaffected by forces that altered the makeup and function of the state in modern times. By the middle of the 19th century, four dimensions of royal authority underscored Iran's historical experiences. The first was the pre-Islamic tradition of kingship as transmitted through political culture and practice of government and through manuals of government, general histories, and epic legends, such as Ferdowsi's Shahnameh. The second was the Islamic, and more specifically the Shiite, dimension of government, which essentially aimed at reconciling Persian kingship with the complex notion of political authority in Islam. The third was the nomadic concept of power and leadership, which at least since the Turkish and Mongol invasions of the 11th to 14th centuries had been a persistent feature of the Islamic state. The final influence was the modern Western model of government, and examples of European kingship as they became known to Persian and other Middle Eastern rulers from the early decades of the 19th century. The Persian monarchical model, a legacy of the Sasanian period, 244 to 640, and before, persisted for centuries in the Islamic world with few interruptions. After the decline of the Abbasid Caliphate in the 9th century, for all intents and purposes, the institution of the Sultanate was a revival of the Persian model. But even before the Bayad rulers of central and southern Iran, 932 to 1062, who were of Shiite persuasion, had adopted the Persian imperial title of King of Kings, Shahanshah, whereas their Sunni rivals, the Samanids of Khorasan and Central Asia, 819 to 1005, proud of their Sasanian lineage, had upheld the old courtly practices and patronized the revival of Persian language and culture. In the heyday of the Ghaznavid, 998 to 1050, and the Seljukid, 1038 to 1194 empires, when loyalty to the caliphate was strong, and when the Turkish ancestry of the sultans was pronounced, and later during the Ilkhanid period, 1256 to 1335, Persian ministers were successful in persuading the rulers to embrace a traditional kingly posture and to observe the norms of monarchical rule. The celebrated Persian minister, Khwaja Abu Ali Hassan Nizam al-Mulch, died 1092, who considered the symbiosis between monarchy and good religion as a basis for social stability, was indeed advocating a theory set forth by Zoroastrian writers of the 6th century. This aspect of kingship, the need for compatibility between state and religion, was further stressed in the Safavid period, with the Shiite Shahs claiming a dual authority. They were viewed both as temporal rulers presiding over the state and, at least up to the early 17th century, as deputies of the Shiite imam and thus as custodians of the Shiite community. Safavid rulers enhanced such a merging of temporal and religious spheres by granting patronage to 12 Shiite ulama and incorporating them into the state apparatus. However, the Safavid Shahs did not abandon their royal premises and practices. The subjects of the Safavid Empire regarded the monarchy, if not the person of the Shah, as an exalted institution, crucial for preserving Shi'ism within its oft-threatened boundaries. That there were attempts to resuscitate the Safavid monarchy, including several by pretenders claiming Safavid descent, attests to the endurance of this temporal religious model for at least half a century after that dynasty's demise. The early Qajars did not claim to be of Safavid descent, nor did they pretend to rule on behalf of a nominal Safavid Shah, as did Nadir in his early days, and Karim Khan, the Vakil, deputy, throughout his rule. But they nevertheless tried to sustain an air of legitimacy as protectors of the Shiite domain and upholders of the Shiite religious order. Equally important for the Qajar dynasty's survival, however, was its ability to maintain a notion of social justice in its dealings with its subjects. Around the patrimonial figure of the Shah were shaped the institutions of government, and through him the bonds with his subjects were forged. The early Qajar rulers honoured, at least in principle, the paradigm that divided the state, Dolat, from the subjects, Raiyat, and defined the place and functions of each of the two components. The Shah viewed his bond with the subjects, the peasants, the urbanites, and the nomads, as one of a social contract. In exchange for the state's providing security and order, the subjects were expected to remain obedient and economically productive. In such a model, the Shah was at the top of the social pyramid, and the ultimate exemplar within a hierarchy that replicated his patriarchal authority at all lower urban, tribal, and familial levels. Every man of stature and authority, the ulama, landlords, chiefs of tribes, city wardens, chiefs of the merchants, masters of the guilds, and leaders of the Sufi orders, was expected to mind his flock and be responsible for its conduct. Notwithstanding the patrimonial nature of royal authority, the Perso-Islamic model of state summed up the duties of the ruler in two complementary functions: defense of the kingdom from external threats and administration of justice within the kingdom. In reality, defense of the land required nothing more than mustering the military forces necessary to quell any invasion or organized rebellion, often of a nomadic nature, whereas dispensing justice was synonymous with preserving the societal order against forces of religious sedition and popular chaos. Discharging these duties required a basic division between the ruler and the ruled, which in turn necessitated intermediary agencies to enforce the royal authority. The rationale for the tripartite interplay between the ruler, the government agents, and the subjects was therefore explained in the form of a causal cycle, the so-called cycle of equity, the maintenance of which was the ruler's responsibility. The kingdom's survival, and that of the king as its head, it was argued, required maintaining an army and a bureaucracy in order to defend the land, enforcing the ruler's command, and collecting taxes. But the revenue could only be generated by the subjects if they lived in peace and security. It was thus incumbent upon the king to ensure that the subjects were treated justly and were immune from his agent's natural tendencies toward oppression. If he failed to do so, the kings were warned in no unsure terms by the authors of government manuals, he would foster popular sedition and rebellion, which would soon remove him from the throne and destroy his dynasty. This rudimentary formula engendered a certain tension within the institution of kingship. It required the ruler to supervise the government apparatus and yet keep a distance from it in order to protect the subjects against the excesses of his own agents. This was often resolved by the ruler's being partially excluded from the routine of governing. Practical power was delegated to ministers and high-ranking officials, but the ruler reserved for himself the discretionary rights of dismissing and promoting, punishing and rewarding. These rights were bestowed upon him because he was considered the locus of divine glory and possessor of royal charisma, Fare-Shahi. He was the shadow of God, Zillallah, on earth. But if he was not capable of maintaining the delicate balance between the government and the subjects, he was destined to lose his divine mandate, and with it his glory and his throne. In principle, the Qajar Shahs, like their predecessors, were aware of these royal duties and recognized the conditionality of their divine mandate. Yet contingencies of their office inevitably occasioned a certain political isolation against which it was hard to prevail. This was intensified by elaborate court protocol, by bureaucratic practices that limited public access to the Shahs, and by their desire for material gains, their fears and insecurities, and their own private lifestyles. Even though they made occasional attempts to break through the strictures of their office by reducing the power of their officials, or eliminating administrative and courtly barriers by personally hearing the grievances of their subjects, they could hardly escape the maws of the monarchy itself. The spectacle of kingly glory on which the ruler's authority rested required from him lofty gestures of generosity and tempered severity, but seriously limited his ultimate task of preserving the balance between the ruling elite and the ruled. The self-image of the Qajar Shah as the nucleus of the ruling elite and as the supreme regulator with divine rights is evident in the use of titles and honorifics and the way these evolved over time. Although the chronicles of the Qajar period showered Aghor Muhammad Khan with many grand appellations, during his own time as ruler he adopted no more grander title than Khan, and later Shah. By contrast, his successor, Fatali Shah, adopted not only the ancient Persian title of Shahanshah, King of Kings, but also the Turco-Mongol title of Khagan, the Khan of the Khans, symbolizing claims over both the throne and the tribes. This lineage was underscored among Fatali Shah's successors. Muhammad Shah was referred to as Khagan, son of Khagan, Nasiruddin Shah as Khagan, son of Khagan, son of Khagan. These royal titles were embellished with an array of other honorifics, reflecting the ruler's desire to present a sense of historical continuity and hence legitimacy. Drawing on the glories of the Persian mythical and dynastic past, the Qajar Shah was acclaimed by court chroniclers and in official records as a world conqueror, Giti Setan, of Alexandrian magnitude, Sikandar Shan, a possessor of Jamshid's glory, Jamjor, of Feridun's charisma, Feridun Far, and of Khosrow's splendor, Kesra Shokat. During times of war and punishment, he was a Turk with the ferocity of Genghis, Changiz Solat, and the vehemence of Tamerlane, Timur Satvat. In peacetime, he was acknowledged as a joyous king, Shahryare Kamkar, and a fortuitous sultan, Sultane Soheb Garan, whose religious and civil duties were also couched in his titles. Above all, he was the shadow of God, Zillallah, upon earth, a refuge of Islam, Islam Pano, and a shield of the Islamic Sharia, Shariat Pano. But he was also a guardian of the Persian kingdom, Hafizah Mulcher Ajam, and more frequently the king, Padishah, of the guarded domains, Memolike Mahruse of Iran. Ample use of grand titles was a practice not limited to the ruler. All the princes of the royal family, members of the nobility, courtiers, government officials, and army officers, and later, under Nasir ad-Din, the Shah's chief wives, all the servants of the inner court, and even those casually connected to the sprawling Qajar court, held titles often unsuitable to their stature and function. For the early Qajar rulers, conferring titles was a way of enhancing the image of royal magnificence. For the recipients, it was a means of acquiring legitimacy in place of rendering service and loyalty. In the highly ceremonious court of Fatali Shah, there was some rationale for granting titles, but by the late Nasir ad-Din period and that of his successor, Muzaffar ad-Din Shah, 1896 to 1906, there was little meaning in such titles beyond the size of the gift presented to the Shah or the ruler's personal favour toward the recipient. The society over which the early Qajars ruled bore the scars of Iran's ravages of earlier decades. By the middle of the 19th century, the population of the country was barely more than 6 million, of which more than 80% resided in the countryside as nomads and villagers. About two-thirds of the population inhabited the northern and central provinces, with heavier concentrations in Azerbaijan, Kirmanshah, northern Khorasan, and Isfahan. The sparsely populated cities and towns throughout the country served as marketplaces for agricultural products of the hinterlands, for regional trade, and for traditional industries with limited access to other domestic or foreign centres. As the century progressed, a semblance of a national economy began to emerge through a commercial network that allowed larger movements of population and goods between provinces. In the northwest lay Tabriz, Iran's largest and the most prosperous city, with a population of more than 100,000 in the 1850s. It was the country's major gateway to the outside world, through which trade was conducted with Russia, the Ottoman Empire, and Europe. In the central southern part of the country, Isfahan, the great capital of the Safavid Empire, with a population no larger than 60,000, still preserved its religious and, to some extent, its cultural and commercial predominance, even though it had suffered greatly in the turbulent interregnums of the post-Safavid period. By the early decades of the Qajar era, Shiraz, the provincial centre of the ancient Fars province and the capital of the Zand dynasty, also maintained something of its flourishing past because of the revival of the Persian Gulf trade. Other centres, such as Yazd in central southern Iran, Kirman in the southeast, Mashhad in the northeast, and Qazvin in the central north, also enjoyed economic revivals primarily because of trade with neighbouring lands. Commercial seaports, such as Mohammareh, Bushehr, and Bandari Abbas, along the Persian Gulf, possessed some vitality due to maritime trade with British India and Muscat. Barfurush and Rasht in the north also benefited from the Caspian trade with Russia and the Caucasus. Tehran, the new capital inaugurated by Agha Mohammad Khan in 1786, even after half a century of Qajar rule, barely accommodated a population of more than 80,000. Originally a resort hamlet in the southern foothills of the central Elburz range, north of the old city of Reya, Rages of ancient times, Tehran first emerged in the middle of the 17th century as a Safavid garrison town because of its strategic position as a gateway to the north. Karim Khan Zand had built a small residence there to keep a closer watch over powerful northern tribes such as the Qajars. Agha Mohammad Khan's choice of his capital was based on a similar concern for control of both the northern and southern regions. He was aware of the loyalties of the inhabitants of previous capitals, Isfahan and Shiraz, to the Safavid and Zand dynasties, respectively, and was wary of the power of the notables in these cities. He probably viewed Tehran's lack of a substantial urban structure as a blessing, because it minimized the chances of resistance to his rule by the notables and by the general public. These cities were also vulnerable to the onslaughts of the Bakhtiaris of Isfahan and the tribes of central and southern Fars. Moreover, the Qajar ruler was anxious to maintain his firm hold over his own power base in Astarabad and to remain within close reach of Azerbaijan and the Caucasus. That Tehran was designated in the Fath Ali Shah era both the abode of monarchy, Dar al-Sultanah, and the abode of the caliphate, Dar al-Khilafah, reflects the Qajars' view of their capital as the seat of a dual authority, the temporal sovereignty of the Shah and the religious custodianship, caliphate, that the Qajar ruler hoped to uphold on the Safavid model. The Qajars tried to follow the Safavid example, not only by naming their capital grandly, but also by physically brandishing its image. Under Fath Ali Shah, Gulistan Palace was enlarged and beautified. The citadel, Arg, was extended to include new barracks, and other palaces were built in the vicinity of the capital. The old city quarters were expanded, and new quarters developed to house the growing population. Tehran Bazaar was renovated and enlarged, and as a sign of Qajar patronage, a royal mosque and a central square were constructed adjacent to the citadel. Yet, despite these improvements, Tehran's development was hindered by the lack of substantial commercial and other economic enterprises. As Iran's political capital, it was overshadowed by Tabriz and Isfahan, a fact that explains the Qajar's recognition of Tabriz, the seat of the crown prince since the beginning of the 19th century, as another Dar al-Sultanah, a designation that also symbolized a sharing of royal power between the ruler and his crown prince. Persian cities were divided into city wards, each with its own headman, Kadkhoda, who served under a magistrate, or mayor, Kalantar, who himself answered to the provincial governor. The villagers and tribespeople were organized under similar leaders who were responsible to provincial authorities. Though the Qajar period suffered from a degree of administrative chaos, informal power structure and confused definition of offices, the basic precept of a patrimonial hierarchy remained intact. In the cities, the guild organizations, asnaf, also served as a parallel urban structure, representing professional interests recognized by the state for taxation and other purposes. The Shah's informal hold over the city notables, the bazaar and the ulama, as well as his indirect control over the nomads and the peasants in the countryside, naturally restricted the sphere of his effective power. Instead, the symbolic essence of his office as a supreme regulator was reinforced. Increasingly, the Qajar Shah upheld his royal supremacy over the guarded domains of Iran, not so much by military force and administrative surveillance, as by royal grandiosity, symbolic punishments and rewards, and sheer political maneuvering. This curious mix of formal facade and informal practice was visible at every level of the government in its treatment of its subjects. Within fragile frontiers. An element of continuity in Iran's political order is best observed in the endurance of its geopolitical boundaries. The Qajar territorial equilibrium, which, with the exception of some losses on the periphery, continued throughout the 19th century, was founded on tangible historical precedents. The frontiers of the guarded domains of Iran, Mamolike Mahraseye Iran, as the country had been defined since Safavid times, were almost the same as those in the 5th century definition of Iran Shah in the Sasanian manual Nomeya Tansar, and those outlined by 14th century geographer Hamdullah Mustofi, the author of Nazhat al-Golub. In Qajar times, Iran's borders with the Ottoman Empire stretched across the western Caucasus and eastern Anatolia, along the Zagros Range, to the northwestern tip of the Persian Gulf. In spite of serious challenges from both sides, which led to several episodes of occupation of Iran's western provinces by the Ottomans, these common frontiers proved to be essentially unalterable. Nadir's largely unsuccessful campaigns against the Ottomans in Iraq in the 1730s and Karim Khan's abortive attempt to conquer Basra in 1775-1779 exhibited Iran's handicap in securing permanent territorial gains beyond the Zagros Range. The earlier Qajar Shahs and their contemporary Ottoman sultans entertained expansionist ambitions along these turbulent frontiers. Yet, despite disputes over Kurdish and Arab tribes of Kurdistan and Khuzestan, and over the Persian pilgrims to the Shiite holy cities of Iraq, there was no significant shift in boundary lines, which were set as early as the Treaty of Amasya in 1555. In spite of instability along the Perso-Ottoman borders, during the 19th century there was growth in commercial and human exchanges between the two countries. Most significant, there was an increase in the volume of the Persian pilgrimage traffic to the shrine cities of Najaf and Karbala in Ottoman Iraq. Veneration for the Shiite imams, whose shrines were adorned by the rulers of Iran, made the Persian public more aware of its Shiite identity. Pilgrims to these holy cities also paid homage to the ulama, who, since the late 18th century, had been residing there in greater numbers. They presided over teaching circles, which attracted large numbers of students from Iran. Through these students, who returned to Iran to occupy religious positions in their local communities, senior jurists, mujtahids, in Iraq, were able to exercise wider authority over the religious affairs of Iran. Their followers throughout the Shiite world also grew larger once the means of communication with them improved. At times, the decisions of these religious dignitaries clashed with the policies of the Persian state, but by and large they relied on the Qajar rulers to be their protectors and benefactors. Throughout the Qajar era, the Ottoman Empire also served as a window to Europe and an important conduit for the adoption of Western-style administrative and other measures. Nearly all reform-minded statesmen of the Qajar period were exposed at some stage in their careers to modernization efforts in the neighboring empire. These men looked upon the reforms of Mahmud II and the Tanzimat era as models for state-sponsored reforms in their own country. The Qajar Shahs, however, viewed these attempts in their neighbouring empire with ambivalence. They often saw such measures as hazardous departures from the old ways, changes that could jeopardise the security of their realm and the survival of their throne. The loss of Ottoman provinces to nationalist movements in the Balkans and growing European intervention in the internal affairs of the Ottoman Empire dampened whatever enthusiasm they entertained for change. The two worlds of the Persians and Ottomans thus remained essentially divided along a religio-linguistic chasm that could only be crossed by an intellectual minority. Iran's eastern frontiers were more volatile and culturally barren. From the Central Asian Khanates of Khiva, Marv, and Bukhara in the northeast, to Herat and Kandahar in the east, to Balochistan and Makran in the southeast, the Persian frontiers witnessed persistent nomadic incursions. Turkoman, Afghan, and occasionally Baluch encroachments into the interiors of Khorasan and neighbouring provinces ravaged the countryside and interrupted the flow of eastern trade with India and Central Asia. The Sunni Turkoman raiders' common practice of abducting villagers and townsmen of Khorasan to sell in the slave markets of Khiva and Bukhara in Central Asia was a major menace to the Qajar government and damaged its reputation. Retaliatory campaigns to quell the Turkoman threat and to reassert sovereignty over eastern principalities, most notably Herat and Marv, were of limited effect and a constant drain on the state's limited resources. Down to the closing decades of the 19th century, when Russia completed the annexation of the Khanates of Central Asia and a partially integrated Afghanistan emerged under British custody, the threat to the Persian eastern frontiers remained unabated. The Turkoman and Afghan raids weakened Iran's old ties with Transoxania and in effect contributed to Khorasan's cultural and commercial decline. The fervent upholding of Sunni Islam in Central Asia did not ease off after the demise of the Uzbek kingdom of the 16th and 17th centuries. Shiite Iran thus continued to be enveloped on its eastern front by an unsympathetic, if not hostile, Sunni creed, in much the same way as it was surrounded on its western front by the Sunni Ottomans. As a legacy of the Safavid era, Iran's ethno-religious solitude only reaffirmed its national integration. The notion of guarded domains thus represented a sense of territorial and political homogeneity in a country in which the Persian language, culture, kingship, and culture and the Shiite religious creed became inseparable parts of the evolving national identity. The fact that Iran's neighbours on its northern and southern frontiers were two rival powers, Russia and Britain, also reflected its geopolitical containment. Highly influential in the political, economic, and socio-cultural making of modern Iran, these powers came into wider contact with Iran when it was about to recover from the political malaise and isolation of earlier decades. Since the 18th century, Russia's ambitions in the Caucasus and on the Caspian coast had been a matter of occasional concern for the Safavids and their successor states. But in the first quarter of the 19th century, the Qajar state was compelled to give the greatest priority to the threat coming from the northern neighbour. Loss of territory and prestige during two rounds of Russo-Persian wars, 1805-13 and 1826-1828, combined with the ensuing bankruptcy, culminated in the Turkmanchay Treaty of 1828. This treaty permanently severed the Caucasian provinces from Iran and settled the Russo-Persian northwestern boundary along the Aras River. It also imposed on Iran enduring capitulatory and other types of restrictions alien to the Persian notion of sovereignty. The psychological impact of defeat was only magnified by Russia's conquests on the northeastern periphery in the following decades and its postures of advancing toward the northern provinces of Iran proper. In Iran's 19th century political history, there have been few events as pivotal as war with Russia. The Qajar government and society were quick to recognize the Russian threat, but came to terms with it with difficulty. The Griboyedov incident in 1829, in the aftermath of the war, when a Russian diplomatic mission was massacred by the Tehran mob, was one symptom of public disenchantment with the humiliating submission to a Christian power. In the following decades, with varying intensity, Russia held the implicit threat of military occupation as a Damoclean sword over the Qajar state in order to accomplish diplomatic and other objectives. Russian advances in the Khanates of Central Asia from the early 1860s to late 1880s were seen in Tehran as a mixed blessing. The Qajars were alarmed at the possibility of losing Khorasan and the Caspian provinces to Russia, while at the same time being relieved of the Turkoman menace on their frontiers. With British India stretching by the 1820s as far as Iran's southeastern flank and soon afterward dominating the Persian Gulf, Qajar Iran was bound to view such colonial ascendancy with mixed sentiments. The Persian government viewed Britain as a potential threat to Iran's southern provinces, yet considered it a natural ally, a counterbalance against the belligerent northern neighbour. In turn, Britain treated Iran with a mixture of accord and distrust. It recognised Iran's value as an ally in pacifying India's northwestern frontiers at the turn of the 19th century, and soon after as a buffer state against the potential Russian threat to India. Yet, over time, British authorities became increasingly suspicious of Iran and the possibility that it might succumb to Russian pressure. In the first quarter of the 19th century, a level of cooperation in defence and commerce existed between the two neighbours, even though Britain reneged on some of its defence commitments during the Russo-Persian Wars. British diplomatic relations with Iran, first officially launched by Sir John Malcolm and his mission in 1800, were primarily aimed at safeguarding the interests of the British East India Company. The British emissaries were admired in the Persian court for their resourcefulness and prudence, and were viewed with an esteem only matched by the Persians' grudging fear of Russian diplomats and generals. What made the relations between Iran and both its neighbours problematic in the decades following defeat in wars with Russia was a change in Europe's image of Iran from a mighty and enduring empire to a weak and vulnerable buffer state. The Anglo-Russian contest for supremacy over Central Asia and excessive British concern for the defence of India turned Iran in the eyes of its European neighbours into a pawn in the great game. The Persian state came to be seen condescendingly as one that ought to be contained within its frontiers, coaxed by diplomacy at the centre, and, if need be, driven into submission, but not militarily conquered, by punitive action. For the British, the Qajar handicap for withstanding the Russian military thrust was concomitant with Iran's obedience to Russian wishes, a prospect Britain tried to resist at all costs. The Russians entertained the same concern in reverse. Throughout the Qajar era, then, Iran became the centre stage for a power rivalry between Russia and Britain that often involved concerns for prestige, petty frictions between the representatives of the European powers, and the wishes and interests of the faction-ridden Qajar ruling elite. Given the bipolar nature of Iran's diplomacy, it was natural for the Persian government to utilize the Anglo-Russian rivalry to safeguard its own interests and maximize its otherwise meager diplomatic gains. Yet such a course of policy was interpreted by both European powers as evidence of intrigue and malicious intent. Thus, to counter the supposed or real influence of the rival party, both powers regarded meddling in Iran's internal affairs a legitimate extension of their diplomacy. More often by direct pressure on the Persian government, but also through protégés and proxies, British and Russian envoys began influencing domestic issues ranging from dynastic succession and court protocol to litigation, citizenship, and customs tariffs. Such foreign meddlings were facilitated by structural weaknesses in the Qajar government, by intrinsic corruption and disloyalty among officials, and by rising discontent among the Persian public. From the second quarter of the 19th century on, Qajar rulers and many of their high officials were encouraged to rely on foreign backing in order to compensate for their diminishing support among the populace. Beyond the sphere of diplomacy, elements of Western-style reform began to influence a small but powerful upper crust of the state elite, beginning in the early decades of Qajar rule. Defeat in the war with Russia made the Qajars more aware of their military deficiencies and encouraged them to adopt modern weaponry and elements of European warfare in organization of the troops. Most significant, the creation of the new army, Nizam-e-Jadid, under the Crown Prince Abbas Mirza in Azerbaijan after 1813, and elsewhere under other prince governors, reinforced the Qajar war ethos and transformed the state's perceptions of its power in dealings with its own subjects and with its neighbours. Throughout the 19th century, the desire for military reform brought into the Iranian environment a host of generals, drill officers, and military advisers from Britain, France, Russia, Austria, Italy, and elsewhere. Together with European diplomats, merchants, and missionaries, they were the most important channels through which the Persians acquired an early knowledge of the West. For the Qajar Shah and the princely elite from Abbas Mirza onward, images of European power took the form not only of military hardware and troop formation, but of dress and appearance as well. They adopted European dress for themselves and their new army to underscore their readiness to defend the land and the faith. The stark contrast between Fath Ali Shah's traditional appearance, which included an ornamented Persian long robe, high heels, and a long beard, and the appearance of his successor, Muhammad Shah, who sported semi-Europeanized dress and a short beard, clearly speaks to this change of the royal image. After an initial squabble, even the ulama reluctantly consented to the Qajar adoption of European dress. The early Qajar statesmen argued that the Shah's duties obligated him and the men of the sword in general to adopt necessary means against the imminent threat of foreign aggression, and that the change of dress was a necessary symbol for the overhaul of the country's defence. The symbolism of the royal shift to European outfits in a culture deeply observant of its dress code went beyond sheer military need. Gradual adoption of European dress heralded a Qajar desire to set forth a new example of monarchy that was more disciplined and forceful, an image deemed necessary to mend the injured legitimacy of the monarchy, and mindful of Iran's need to bridge its growing material gap with the outside world. Nobility and the problem of succession. The early Qajars were successful in securing a certain degree of stability by sharing power with princes of the blood and other influential members of the dominant clan. Yet the greatest quandary for them was the question of succession and the rule of primogeniture, the exclusive right of the firstborn to the throne. For more than half a century, between Aghor Muhammad Khan's reign and Nasir ad-Din's accession in 1848, diverse forces accelerated or hindered the process of succession. Chief among them were inter-tribal divisions, tensions within the royal family, the wishes of the foreign powers, and the vested interests of the bureaucracy. Conscious of the ever-present threat of tribal discord, as early as 1789, Aghor Muhammad Khan stipulated that the crown should pass to the first son born of the bond between the two powerful clans of the Qajar house, the Govanlu and the Davalu. Aghor Muhammad Khan's aspirations for the continuity of his empire were thus projected in the progenitive capacities of his successor. With similar considerations in mind, Fath Ali Shah married his son and celebrated heir, Abbas Mirza, to a daughter of Davalu. He also instructed other princes of the royal family to take brides from other Qajar branches. Healing the age-old tribal rifts between the two chief branches of the Qajar tribe was no doubt the immediate aim for these unions. The ruling family was initially from the Govanlu or Goyunlu, the sheep clan that was the principal lineage of the six clans of the Ashugabash, the downstream settlers, sub-tribe of the Qajar tribe. By contrast, the Davalu, the camel clan, was the chief clan of the Yohairi Bash, the upstream settlers. The hostility between the two clans intensified in the late 18th century. When the Qajars came to power, the memories of defections and betrayals that had cost the lives of three successive Govanlu leaders and had caused much fratricide and bloodshed among the Qajars of Astarabad still rankled, especially in the minds of the mothers, sisters, and daughters of the slain warriors. Aghor Muhammad Khan's merciless struggle against his Qajar rivals, both Davalu and Govanlu, further exacerbated these ill feelings. Fath Ali Shah could not have fulfilled the expectations of his predecessor more fittingly. During the 47 years of his adult life, 35 of which he spent on the throne, he single-handedly generated a royal family of unprecedented size. He brought close to 1,000 wives of diverse origin, class, age, and function to his royal harem. He married not only the daughters of the Qajars and other tribal chiefs, including ex-wives of his paternal uncles, but also the daughters of high-ranking officials, merchants, and urban notables, women captured in wars with the remnants of the vanquished dynasties, the Afsharids and the Zands, Persian and Georgian slave girls, and a host of concubines, entertainers, and women servants who crowded the expanding inner quarters, Andarun, of the Shah. They bore him offspring at a rate that truly made Fath Ali Shah one of the most fertile men in history. Between January and November 1789 alone, shortly after his official designation to a parency, his wives gave birth to no less than 7 sons, 3 of whom, including Abbas Mirza, were born within 10 days. By the time of his death in 1834, he left behind some 60 sons and more than 40 daughters. The record of Fath Ali Shah's children is no less impressive. His first 10 sons, the most powerful princes of the royal house, had between them a total of 333 children, 175 sons and 158 daughters. The assessment of the court historian Sepehra, who placed the number of Fath Ali's surviving offspring in 1834 at 786, does not seem to be an exaggeration. "It is not implausible," he added, "that by now they have multiplied to 10,000. Thanks to Fath Ali and his sons, in the relatively short period of half a century and over a span of 5 generations between Aghor Muhammad Khan and Nasir ad-Din Shah, a new royal nobility was created that could reduce to uneasy submission all rival forces, both within and outside of the Qajar tribe. The aptitude of Fath Ali Shah and the royal princes to assemble households of such proportion certainly went beyond the boundaries of family love or lustful pleasure, the latter becoming the subject of frequent criticism and ridicule by later observers. In many instances, sheer political expediency was the only motivation to marry women of diverse tribal origins. These were wives whom the king and the royal princes often disliked for their odious arrogance, but nonetheless tolerated for their worth as pawns or hostages in a complicated political game. Union as such was an effective method by which to consolidate the Qajar throne. Discussing the high-ranking wives of his father, Ahmad Mirza Azadul-Dole, the 49th son of Fath Ali Shah, noted, "It was merely for the peaceful unification of the tribes and clans, and for the expression of kingly mercy, that these wives became the subjects of royal favour and respect." For all the blame and criticism Fath Ali Shah often receives for his life of extravagance and pleasure-seeking, he should be credited for transforming, largely by peaceful means, the Qajar tribe from a diffuse oligarchy with shaky loyalties into a closely knit patrimony. The earliest attempts to enforce a rule of succession proved to be ineffective in relaxing the tension between the Shah's numerous sons. Not until Nasir ad-Din Shah's reign did the Qajars fully replace the custom of free and often bloody contest for succession with the norm of primogeniture. Although Abbas Mirza's nomination was seldom disputed openly by Fath Ali Shah himself, the crown prince was periodically challenged by his powerful brothers, who felt they were equally justified in their claim to a parency. The system of provincial tutelage under Fath Ali, in practice, divided Iran among the senior princes of the Qajar house, allowing them to have their miniature court and administration and a large measure of independence in the conduct of their affairs. By the 1820s, there were at least 4 other potential candidates for succession among the sons of the Shah, 3 of whom were eligible because of their maternal Qajar lineage, their proximity in age to the crown prince, and above all their political leverage over the Shah. Fath Ali himself, who increasingly felt the pressure brought on him by his sons, fostered a level of competition among them, a competition that was not without its later costs to the crown and the country. Fraternal strife among the Qajar princes in turn introduced new factors into the process of succession, of which the most important was the prospect of foreign intercession. Abbas Mirza's position as the crown prince, the vice-regent, Noeb al-Sultaneh, and the governor-general of the province of Azerbaijan, was no doubt the strongest among senior princes, even though it was complicated by the burdensome task of defending the northwestern frontiers against Russia. The sobering experience of defeat in the first round of the Russo-Persian Wars, 1805 to 1813, and the loss of territories in the Caucasus, had already jeopardized his predominance. In subsequent years, the anxious prince tried to consolidate his position by making himself equally indispensable to Fath Ali Shah in Tehran, to the Tsar in St. Petersburg, and to the British government in London. He began to appreciate the benefits of maintaining friendly relations with Iran's northern neighbour, although such relations did not wholly extinguish his chronic desire to recapture lost territories. The Treaty of Golestan, 1813, which ended the first round of Russo-Persian wars, guaranteed the Tsar's support for the Crown Prince of Iran, but it also barred the Russian sovereign from interfering in the choice of the heir apparent should a dispute develop among the princes. At about the same time, the treaties of 1812 and 1814 with England stipulated similar assurances. Although these provisions seemed intended to strengthen Abbas Mirza's hand, they also left the door open for future challenges by his brothers. Such uncertainties in the event of a dispute indicated that in the early decades of Fath Ali's reign, the question of apparency was still not fully resolved. A free-for-all contest between the qualified princes was still to determine the future of the throne. Ironically, the humiliating defeat in the second round of the war with Russia altered this situation in favour of primogeniture. The peace treaty of Turkmanchay in 1828 turned out to be an unforeseen opportunity for Abbas Mirza to secure his own and his descendants' succession. At the end of the war, the remaining parts of the Caucasus and most of Azerbaijan, including the provincial capital Tabriz, were under Russian occupation. The near elimination of the Persian army and the Russian demand for a burdensome war retribution were further causes of distress to the Shah and the Crown Prince. Such terrible losses even obliged Fath Ali to succumb temporarily to the claims of one of his sons, the bellicose Hasan Ali Mirza Shoja al-Sultaneh, then the Governor-General of Khorasan, in his bid to replace Abbas Mirza. If nothing else, this challenge persuaded Abbas Mirza and his minister and chief negotiator, the celebrated Mirza Abul Qasem Gaim Magam, to hasten the peace negotiations with the Russians. In return for accepting nearly all the terms proposed by Russia, the prince and his minister obtained unequivocal recognition of Abbas Mirza as the legitimate heir apparent to the throne. Article 7 of the Treaty of Turkmanchay, 1828, thus declared, "His Majesty the Shah of Persia, having judged it fitting to appoint as his successor and heir presumptive his august son, Prince Abbas Mirza, His Majesty the Emperor of all the Russia, with a view to giving to His Majesty the Shah public evidence of his friendly dispositions and his desire to contribute to the consolidation of this order of succession, undertake to recognize Prince Abbas Mirza, the successor and heir presumptive of the Crown of Persia, and to consider him the legitimate sovereign to this kingdom from his accession to the throne." This article suited both sides. It suited the Russians because it put within their reach a weaker and more vulnerable crown prince receptive to their persuasions. Moreover, clear recognition of Abbas Mirza as the new heir apparent was a precautionary measure by Russia, and soon after by Britain, to preempt a dynastic war after the death of the ruling monarch. Abbas Mirza himself, understandably apprehensive of his father's uncertainties and of the intrigues of the Tehran court, looked also for alternative support. The second defeat had reduced his popularity, both in Azerbaijan and in the capital, and acknowledgement of his legitimacy by the victorious Russians was necessary if he was to survive the challenge of his jealous brothers. An even more important outcome of the above article was the future continuity of succession among Abbas Mirza's descendants. Although Article 7 of Turkmanchay did not stipulate any such guarantees, its interpretation in favour of Abbas Mirza's house, which came about in 1833 with his premature death, was of lasting significance. Fath Ali Shah designated Muhammad Mirza, Abbas's son, as heir apparent. but the near-equal seniority of at least three of the Shah's own sons made compliance with the rule of primogeniture a risky enterprise. To justify the unconventional choice of the grandson as heir, Qajar historians, including Jahangir Mirza, another son of Abbas Mirza, who himself later was a casualty of the struggle for succession, resorted to seeking precedent in Iran's history from Timurid and Safavid times. The Shah's decision was tenuously viewed by the neighbouring powers as a legitimate interpretation of the spirit of the Turkmanchay Treaty. Predictably, such interpretation was not accepted without serious dissent within the royal family. Upon the death of Fath Ali Shah in 1834, a war of succession broke out that involved at least three pretenders to the throne from among the sons of the late Shah. These formidable pretenders were overcome through a combination of domestic and foreign assistance that Muhammad Shah and his aides and officials managed to muster. When he set out from Tabriz in 1834 to capture the capital, Muhammad Shah had in his company the European-trained New Army of Azerbaijan, the British and Russian officers and diplomats supportive of his claim, and statesmen of his father's court. These were formidable forces that put Muhammad Mirza's contestants at a clear disadvantage. The defeat of the pretenders in Tehran, Isfahan, and Shiraz was followed by a rapid shift of loyalties among the associated nobles and officials to Muhammad Shah's camp. The prevalence of Abbas Mirza's house thus marked the effective political end for most, if not all, other princes of the Fath Ali Shah line and their descendants, whose meagre means from land tenure and pensions could barely meet their needs. However, the house of Abbas Mirza, the final winner of the struggle for succession, was never entirely free from internal tension. Brothers of Muhammad Shah proved to be formidable challenges, not only to the young Shah, but even more so to Nasir ad-Din Mirza, his heir to the throne. 1. The Child of Turkmanchay. In September 1819, the Qajar ruler of Iran, Fath Ali Shah, summoned to the capital his grandson, Muhammad Mirza, the 12-year-old son of Crown Prince Abbas Mirza, to marry him with Malik Jahan, a 14-year-old bride of the Govanlu branch of the ruling dynasty. Muhammad Mirza and Malik Jahan were Nasir al-Din's parents. The marital bond, part of an ambitious scheme of genealogical engineering undertaken by the monarch, was calculated to heal the internecine conflicts that divided the early Qajars. At least three sources considered it important to record the alleged instructions for establishing marriage bonds between the royal house and the rival factions of the Qajar tribe. Proclaimed by Aghor Muhammad Khan, the castrated founder of the dynasty, the instructions were passed on to his super-procreant nephew and successor, Fath Ali Shah. Marry the daughter of Mirza Muhammad Khan Baglabargi Davalu to your son and crown prince Abbas Mirza, who himself is, from his distaff side, a Davalu, so that his son, who shall bear my name, Muhammad, will descend from both houses of the Qajar like his father. My uncle, Suleiman Khan, Govanlu, has faithfully toiled at the service of our state. Give one of your daughters to one of his sons, and the child of this union will bear a daughter who shall be betrothed to Muhammad Mirza. The son who, God willing, will be born of this union, will be your great-grandson from both sides. Then all will be Govanlu, all will be Govanlu. This prognostic testimony, at least in its embellished version, sounds more like an apocryphal report produced by court chroniclers anxious to sanctify the right of the dominant Govanlu, and in particular Abbas Mirza's progeny, to the throne. More important, it meant to attach a predestined impeccability to the noble origins of Nasir al-Din Shah, the fourth ruler of the Qajar dynasty, and the final product of this complex marital scheme. Unhappy union. Nasir al-Din Mirza, the first surviving child of Muhammad Mirza and Malik Jahan, was born on 17th July 1831, 6th Safar 1247, Gamari, in the village of Konamir, some 15 miles south of Tabriz. The pregnant Malik Jahan must have been driven to the summer resort to escape the heat, or possibly an outbreak of cholera in the provincial capital. Giving birth to a child in a remote village was not unusual for the Qajar royal family, still accustomed to spending weeks, even months, out in the country. Muhammad Mirza, meanwhile, in the company of his father, Abbas Mirza, the crown prince, was out campaigning against the tribal warlords of northeastern Khorasan. Indeed, the very name, Nasir al-Din, the helper or supporter of the faith, may have been given to the child instead of an ancestral name, in anticipation of his father's victory over the unruly Sunni Turkoman tribes of the northern frontiers. The royal army released more than 20,000 Shiite captives, who were to have been sold in the slave markets of Central Asia, and this benevolent action must have given the campaigning Muhammad Mirza cause for pride. Nasir al-Din's great-grandfather, Fath Ali Shah, concurrently reviewing his troops in a camp in central Iran, celebrated the new birth, as the chronicler Hedayat puts it, on the emerald-like meadow with the melted ruby wine. The Shah must have been pleased with the news of yet another addition to the royal flock, but perhaps neither he nor Abbas Mirza or Muhammad Mirza ever expected such a sudden turn of events as those that in less than 4 years made the infant prince from among numerous contestants first in line to the Qajar throne. In spite of the auspicious birth of the prince, and in spite of all the good wishes of Fath Ali Shah and the crown prince Abbas Mirza, the marriage of convenience between Muhammad Mirza and Malik Jahan proved an unhappy one even by the standards of royal unions. The widening gap between the prince and his wife seemed predictable from the start, given the sheer weight of political benefits the royal family expected from this bond. The tension between the prince's Davalu mother and his Govanlu bride did not help to smooth the couple's married life. Moreover, a personality conflict between the prince and his bride was exacerbated over the years by the bitter experience of losing several infant children. By the time their two surviving children, Nasir al-Din and his sister, Malikzadeh, later Izzat al-Dawla, were born, some 12 years after the couple's ceremonial matrimony in 1819, they had both developed personalities of their own, with dispositions distinctly at odds with one another. Nasir al-Din Mirza was the unfavoured child of this problematic union. The adverse effects of the couple's discord remained visible not only in his troubled childhood, but throughout his adult life. The contrasting personalities of his parents, the introverted and impressionable Muhammad Mirza versus the energetic and domineering Malik Jahan, were exacerbated by other factors, primarily the factional tension between the Govanlu and Davalu families, and the ominous shadow of the premier, Haji Mirza Agassi, over Muhammad Shah as moral mentor and fatherly authority. Muhammad Mirza, the eldest of Abbas Mirza's 25 sons, was born in 1808 in Tabriz. As far as can be determined about his childhood and youth, he was a taciturn and rather remote boy, with no obvious ambition for leadership. His upbringing in Tabriz typified the traditional courtly education that some princes of his time received from the articulate government officials and scribes in the crown prince's service. Even more distant than their father's generation from the habits and manners of the nomadic Qajars, Muhammad Mirza and his brothers were well exposed to the subtleties of Persian civil life. At a strikingly short remove from the uncouth tent dwellers of Astarabad, as brief as a mere decade, the princes of the royal family were busy studying classical texts of Persian literature, the intricacies of Arabic syntax, the rudiments of the Shiite religion, and the art of calligraphy. The latter subject was particularly favoured by Muhammad Mirza, who, like his father, his grandfather, and a few of his uncles and brothers, was a calligrapher of some skill. Later in life, in tune with his ascetic lifestyle, he developed a somewhat anti-European attitude, though, being the son of Abbas Mirza and living in the Tabriz of the 1820s and 1830s, he was well exposed to European ways. The English traveller and observer James Bailey Fraser, who met Muhammad Mirza in 1834, just before his appointment as heir apparent, describes him as the worthiest of all the numerous descendants of Fath Ali Shah, particularly in the point of morals and private character. Although in talent, Fraser stated condescendingly, Muhammad Mirza could not claim an abundance. In military affairs, he bids fair for competence, at least. Take him for all in all as a prince and a Qajar. He is a rarity in Persia. Fraser described him as gracious and smiling, and found his manner void of all those blustering assumptions of greatness that were so offensive in many of the royal family. The credit for Muhammad Mirza's accomplishments, as well as for his presiding over a period of cultural revival, reforms, and contact with Europe, no doubt goes to his enlightened and responsive father, Abbas Mirza. The credit for transmitting the Persian court culture to the Qajars and educating the princes of Abbas Mirza's house, however, belongs to that class of officialdom, the men of the pen, of whom Mirza Isa, Mirza Buzurg Farahoni, Gaim Magam I, died 1821, and his celebrated son Mirza Abdul Qasim, Gaim Magam II, died 1835, were two examples. Encouraged by Abbas Mirza's emphasis on educating his sons and flourishing under the supervision of the Gaim Magams, both father and son, a number of Muhammad Mirza's brothers went beyond a rudimentary education. At least two of them became writers of some repute. Some of that literary and scholarly interest survived up to the time of Nasir al-Din's governorship of Azerbaijan in 1848 and affected his intellectual formation. The refinement of literary taste and adherence to courtly manners, however, was difficult to divorce from the time-honoured war ethos that marked the life of the early Qajars. Muhammad Mirza was still the product of a mixed milieu in which learning and leisure were merged with ferociousness on the battlefield. The expansionist vision of Aghor Muhammad Khan, the founder of the dynasty, and that of his father, Hussein Goli Khan Jahansuz, literally the world burner, the adventurous warlord of Astarabad, was modelled out of the world-conquering aspirations of Genghis and Timur, Tamerlane. Even by the late 19th century, this vision had not altogether vanished from the collective Qajar mentality. Though mellowed by military inferiority and defeat, the Qajar aggression still found expression in dreams of restoring the lost territories of the Safavid and Afsharid empires, as well as in domestic military expeditions and in modes of punishment and torture. To this odd mixture of civility and belligerence, Muhammad Mirza added a third element, one perhaps less typical of the Qajars, but of crucial importance in the formation of his character. A mystical attachment to Haji Mirza Agassi, an eccentric dervish and later his prime minister, proved to be as decisive in the prince's private life as in the shaping of his political career and the early life of his future son, Nasir al-Din Mirza. In the large households maintained by the Shah and his sons, attachments to spiritual figures often compensated for the lack of intimate family relations. More than intellectual curiosity, emotional needs were the driving force behind Muhammad Mirza's search for spiritual guidance. The appearance of Haji Abbas Yerevani on the Tabriz horizon around 1810 has been attributed to Mirza Bozorg's curiosity for the esoteric. A Caucasian émigré of tribal lineage, Mullah Abbas had put behind him a life of adventure and pupilage before slipping into a mullah's attire and being chosen as a tutor to one of Gaim Magam's sons. His mixed bag of popularized Sufi aphorisms and semi-formal religious teachings were attractive enough to earn him, in 1821, the title of Agosi, chief officer of the household, and, 3 years later, the chief tutorship of the crown prince's sons. By this time he had secured sufficient political clout to act as one of Abbas Mirza's counsellors. Muhammad Mirza's acquaintance with Agassi began at an early age when he and his brothers attended the mentor's tutorials. Taking into account Muhammad Mirza's seniority and the fading health of his father, it was not hard for Agassi to forecast the eventual accession of his pupil to the Qajar throne. In the eyes of the impressionable prince, this simple non-committal prediction, perhaps with a little persuasion from Agassi, was seen as evidence of the teacher's miraculous powers. Over the years, Muhammad's devotion to his teacher and his moral dependence on him was reinforced by similar prognostications. By the age of 20, Muhammad Mirza was completely devoted to the largely improvised Sufi teachings of his master. At this time, wrote Jahangir Mirza, the Haji, that is, Agassi, had entirely conquered the temperaments of the late Shah, the term by which the author refers to his deceased brother Muhammad Shah. By means of mysticism, piety, and asceticism, he convinced the late Shah that he is one of the saints. Since the late Shah by nature was ready to acquire apparent and spiritual accomplishments, he recognized the claims of the Haji and planted the seed of his affection in his noble heart. He too modelled his majestic quest upon piety and abstinence. Most lunches and dinners he sufficed partaking a piece of bread and some vinegar. He avoided European dresses and delicacies and, for the rest of his life, abstained from taking Russian sugar and refused to wear European fabrics without first purifying them. Gradually these devotional observations became so obvious that the Crown Prince, that is, Abbas Mirza, could attribute this change of behaviour to Haji's influence. The Crown Prince did not favour especially those matters, such as refraining from punishments and other necessities of sovereignty, which were contrary to temporal kingship. He occasionally rebuked the late Shah, and even obliged him to eat meat and fatty dishes. Asceticism, a vegetarian diet, which may have been observed for health reasons, and observation of the Shiite code of ritual purity were not the only instructions the ailing Muhammad Mirza received from his mentor. In secret, adds Jahangir Mirza, Haji used to complain to the late Shah of his own condition and the undue hostility of Mirza Abul Qasim, Qaim Agam II. He was frequently making such complaints, hoping that one day they would bear fruit. Qaim Magam's rigorous ascendancy over the Crown Prince's household must have given Muhammad Mirza cause for concern. To the minister's authoritarian conduct, Agassi offered a soothing alternative. Soft-hearted and reassuring, the old tutor was a refuge for the prince, a source of solace and renewed confidence. Muhammad Mirza's fondness for Agassi manifested itself as though he was trying to replace the harsh and demanding authority of his own father and that of Qaim Agam, with Agassi's affectionate and fatherly care, a pattern which later repeated itself in the life of his son. Muhammad Mirza's devotion, one may suspect, was not without connection to the prince's problematic marriage. References to Malik Jahan's unfaithfulness, albeit retrospective, suggest an initial sexual incompatibility, if not impotence. Physical mortification was assuaged by a special intimacy with Agassi, and thus served for Muhammad Mirza as a refuge from another source of tension and antagonism. This may partly explain the deep suspicion Malik Jahan reserved for Agassi. Bitterness and rivalry between the two was unavoidable, as Malik Jahan failed to make a dent in the tutor's moral monopoly over her husband. Malik Jahan, the child of a union between the Govanlu chief Amir Qasim Khan and Fat Ali Shah's second daughter, was much more than just a component in the reproductive machinery of the Qajar royal harem. Highly conscious of her Govanlu lineage, she consistently resisted efforts by her husband's Davalu relatives to dismiss her as the insignificant property of her spouse. Her paternal grandfather, Suleiman Khan Etezord al-Dole, the chief of the Ashoka Bash division of the Qajar tribe, had played a key role in the establishment of the Qajars. As the governor-general of Azerbaijan and later chief tutor, Atobak, to Abbas Mirza, he wielded great influence over the Qajar monarch. Her paternal grandmother belonged to the vanquished house of Zand, and probably was awarded as war booty to Suleiman Khan in exchange for his loyal services. Malik Jahan's father, Amir Qasim Khan, who held the supreme position of Amir-e-Kabir, Grand Army Chief, served all his life in the Qajar army, though his death in 1831 may have caused a demotion in the Govanlu status. On the maternal side, Malik Jahan's background featured a union between captor and captive as well. Her grandmother, Fat Ali Shah's first wife, was the daughter of a tribal chief humbled by the Qajars and kept as a hostage in the harem to guarantee the good conduct of her tribe. Besides giving birth to Malik Jahan's mother, she had borne for Fat Ali two of the Shah's most powerful sons, Hussein Ali Mirza Farman Farma and Hassan Ali Shajal Sultana. Often noted for her intelligence and shrewdness, Malik Jahan like some other women of her status, benefited from some education in the harem. Her writing style, her handwriting, and her interest in poetry, she employed a female poet laureate in her private court, testify to her taste and sophistication. Her ambitions, however, went far beyond the seclusion of her husband's inner quarters. From the time of Muhammad Shah's accession to the throne, her presence among the women of the court was second only to that of her mother-in-law, who was of Davalu lineage. More often an advocate of her son than of her husband, Malik Jahan demonstrated her drive for power through her efforts to secure Nasir ad-Din's succession. Her supervision of the interim government in the months following the death of Muhammad Shah in 1848 also testifies to her political talents. Although her part in effecting the fall and execution of Mirza Taghi Khan, Amir Kabir, has tarnished her image beyond repair, her presence behind Nasir ad-Din's throne should not be underestimated. By all accounts, she was probably the most influential woman of the Qajar era, gaining an almost independent political stature. With such a powerful lineage and strong personality, it was not difficult for Malik Jahan to see herself as an equal to Muhammad Mirza, and after 1833, as a legitimate partner in his rising fortune. Being the mother of Muhammad Mirza's first son no doubt enhanced her independent stance as the future queen mother, Madeulya, the sublime cradle, once the heir apparency of Muhammad Mirza was confirmed. Nevertheless, her husband continued to avoid her and gradually grew to dislike her independence and her pride as much as her lack of physical beauty. The tensions in this marital relationship were bound to intensify in the environment of the royal harem, where the prominence of a Davalu queen mother, Muhammad Shah's mother, and the competition of other royal wives and children could very well reduce Malik Jahan and her son to the level of insignificance. Nasir ad-Din was not untouched by these tensions. Lonesome Childhood. In the spring of 1834, Jahangir Mirza, the learned prince and historian of the early Qajar period, anxious to register loyalty to his elder brother Muhammad Mirza, paid a tributary visit to Muhammad's three-year-old son, whom he addressed with his later titles, the King of the Universe, the Essence of Security, Sultan, son of Sultan, and Kagan, son of Kagan, Nasir ad-Din Padishah, may God immortalize his reign. But the symbolic show of submission to the infant prince was to no avail. 5 months later, soon after Fath Ali Shah's death, the ill-fated Jahangir, Bahman Mirza, and three other sons of Abbas Mirza were arrested and imprisoned in the Ardabil citadel in order to preempt plots for the overthrow of the new king, Muhammad Shah. Some months later, Jahangir and his brother, Khosro, were blinded by order of Ghaim Magam I. The new premier justified this gruesome act as a way of consolidating his master's throne in the face of formidable challenges from within the royal family. Ironically, the earliest surviving eyewitness account of Nasir ad-Din thus proved to be one of Jahangir's last visual memories. Deprived of the light of the sight, Jahangir became an early victim in the second round of struggle for succession that ultimately brought Nasir ad-Din to the throne. The blinded prince wisely chose to record the history of the struggle rather than to take further part in it. The precious little that is known of Nasir ad-Din's early childhood in Tabriz was recorded because of his nomination to a parency in 1835. A year before, upon the accession of Muhammad Shah, the predictable dispute over succession placed Nasir ad-Din for the first time at the centre of a prolonged controversy. Two of the Shah's full brothers, Garimon and Bahman, who enjoyed the backing of the Queen Mother and the entire Davalu clan, argued with some vehemence that, in the eye of the foreign powers, a three-year-old child who is still bound to the cradle is not fit to be nominated the crown prince. Such was the attitude of their maternal uncle and scion of the Davalu, Osaf ul-Dowle, who, fearing the departure of the royal blood from the house of Davalu and the ultimate domination of the Govanlu, was determined to prevent Nasir ad-Din's nomination. But Muhammad Shah, still exposed to danger from his rebellious uncles, brothers of Abbas Mirza, was reluctant to abide by the Davalu pressure. The appointment to a parency of anyone but the Shah's son would have violated the same rule of primogeniture that first legitimized his own accession. In principle, the representatives of the foreign powers were supportive of the Shah's rationale, for it complied with the European orders of succession. Yet the foreign representatives, particularly Russia's, were also inclined to utilize the existing tension within Abbas Mirza's house for their own ends, by advocating the appointment of an adult viceroy or regent, Naib al-Sultaneh, in the person of the Shah's brother, Garimun Mirza. The position of Gaim Magam, the Shah's first prime minister, was at best uncertain. Less than a year after his appointment, he was already under attack from his rivals, most notably Asaf al-Dowleh and Haji Mirza Agassi. Isolated within the court and unpopular with the bureaucracy as well as with the foreign envoys, he was clearly losing influence with the Shah, who was always apprehensive of his authoritarian conduct. Gaim Magam's policy of centralization and resistance to foreign and domestic pressure had already made him enemies within the Russian and British legations and among the Davalu dignitaries. Under the circumstances, facilitating the appointment of the young and powerless Nasir al-Din was not his first priority. Instead, he seems to have been promoting the cause of the Shah's once-powerful uncles, particularly Ali Mirza Zil al-Sultan, who, after his unsuccessful bid for the throne and peaceful surrender, was permitted to reside in Tehran. It is not sheer coincidence that the final nomination of Nasir al-Din came immediately after Gaim Magam's downfall. One may suspect that in attempting to restore his control over the Shah, the bold premier toyed with the idea of appointing Zil al-Sultan as regent, a move that literally hammered the last nail in the minister's coffin. Cruel and capricious as it was, the secret strangling of the capable and cultivated Gaim Magam in the crypt of Negaristan Palace in the spring of 1835 was the culmination of years of aggravation and ill-feeling between minister and monarch, perpetuated by the mischiefs of the rival Agassi. The appointment of Haji Mirza Agassi to the office of premier was the Shah's next step, and a move that entailed more than just political benefits. By replacing the authoritarian and highly independent minister with the accommodating and at times innovative tutor, the Shah registered a crucial shift of power from the traditional bureaucratic classes to the inner circles of the court. It was the reverse, at least temporarily, of the policy pursued by Gaim Magam, to monopolize for the premier and the council of the ministers all the appointments, dismissals, disjoining and rejoining of matters, the execution of the government affairs, the allocation of salaries, and assignment of offices. The appointment of Nasir al-Din was a move in the same direction, strengthening the hand of the Shah vis-à-vis the Qajar royal family. The decree of nomination was read to an assembly of army chiefs and provincial officials in Tabriz, where the prince was then residing. The ceremonial insignias of the heir apparency, most revived during Fath Ali Shah's reign for Abbas Mirza, the Kayanid ornamental robe named after the mythological dynasty of the Shahnameh, the dagger, the amulet, and the decoration of the lion and sun, now the official state emblem, were also bestowed upon the young prince. The nomination, approved by the trustees of the Sublime State and the foreign missions, temporarily frustrated the hopes of those who envisaged themselves as regent and kingmaker. No doubt this was a reference to the objection raised by Feridun Mirza, another half-brother of the Shah and Agassi's ex-pupil. Apparently he was set up by his tutor to challenge, unsuccessfully, the Russian-backed Garamon Mirza. In the end, Nasir al-Din's nomination was ratified by representatives of the foreign powers only when Garamon Mirza was granted the acting governorship of Azerbaijan, a position that acknowledged his de facto regency over the minor crown prince. Mirza Mahamad Khan Zangineh, the commander-in-chief of the new army of Azerbaijan, Amir-e-Nizam, was also reinstated in his post as the steward, Pishkar, to Garamon, a typical move by the Shah to place a check on Garamon's autonomy. The young Nasir al-Din had to wait a long time before his heir apparency assumed any real meaning. In the same year, however, shortly after the official nomination, when Captain Stewart, the secretary of the British mission, paid a visit to the young prince in Tabriz, there was little doubt as to Nasir ad-Din's nominal status as the heir apparent. "I never saw so beautiful a child," wrote the Englishman with a taint of exaggeration. "The expression of his countenance is mournful, and the poor thing was evidently shy." A year later, in 1836, when Stuart returned to Azerbaijan, he found the same beautiful but mournful cast of countenance, but this time the prince was terribly bored. The mournful countenance may have very well been conditioned by Nasir ad-Din's fragile physique. His frail appearance was grave enough to elicit a comment by Tsar Nicholas I, reigned 1825 to 1856, when he met the prince in Yerevan, in October 1838. Qajar chroniclers noted the Tsar's concern for Nasir ad-Din's feeble health and weak frame. No particular malady or disability has been reported, but it is hard to dissociate this state of health from the emotional setbacks Nasir ad-Din experienced in his early childhood. Nasir ad-Din's short visit to Yerevan during the Tsar's tour of the newly conquered Caucasian provinces was his first official engagement. On this mission, he was accompanied by a small group of state officials and personal aides, including Muhammad Khan Zangine, the Amir Nizam, Isa Khan Govanlu, the Crown Prince's maternal uncle, his tutor, Mullah Mahmud Nizam al-Ulama Tabrizi, the Mullah Bashi, and Mirza Taghi Khan Farahani, the Army Secretary, Vazir-e-Nizam of Azerbaijan, and later Nasir ad-Din's first Prime Minister. The mission's objective was to convey the Shah's good wishes to Nicholas. At a time when the Shah's preparations for re-establishing sovereignty over Herat, long an objective of the Qajar rulers, had aroused strong British opposition, the Persian government felt it expedient to respond favourably to the Russian Emperor's friendly gesture. By dispatching the Crown Prince to greet the Tsar, ironically in the same provinces taken from Iran less than a decade before, the Shah was also hoping to secure the approval of his northern neighbour for his choice of the heir apparent. Upon arrival in Uch-Kilisor, outside Yerevan, the Persian mission decided to stay in its own tents rather than in the quarters assigned by the Russians. The prince's polite refusal to reside in the town citadel was cherished by the court historians as an early sign.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.